State Department is pulling an agent that specializes in responding to escalated cartel activity.
This is not my department. FBI!
You want to be a part of this?
Do we get an opportunity of the men responsible for today?
The men who are really responsible for today.
Ever been to Juarez before?
We're going to El Paso, right? You're not American. Who do you work for now?
Well, I go where I'm sent.
Every day across that border, people are killed with his blessing. To find him would be like discovering a vaccine.
Nothing will make sense to your American ears.
But in the end, you will understand.
Spotter vehicle, left lane.
Spotter vehicle, 9 o'clock.
Get your weapon out.
I'm not a soldier. This is not what I do.
Juarez is what happens when they dig in. This is it.
Gotta be careful around these people. CIA is not supposed to work this side of the fence.
I just want to know what I'm getting into.
You will not survive here.
You use me as bait.
Freeze!
You saw things you shouldn't have seen. Providing a measure of order that we could control.
I'm gonna tell everyone what you did.
That would be a major mistake.
Nothing will make sense to your podcasting listening ears, and you will doubt everything that we do. But in the end, you will understand. You will understand that Fine Movies, Fine Spirits is back. If you thought the last movie was a lighthearted, adventurous romp, then get ready for this one as we talk about the 2015 action thriller Sicario. And I'm sitting here in position with my Sam Adams porch rocker, but I'm not going into this movie alone. Nope. First up is my good friend, Christopher Morris. And Chris, listen, you must volunteer to be part of this podcast for us. Think very hard before you respond. You want to be a part of this? And if so, what will you be drinking?
I am in, Michael. I am drinking an 87 IPA. It's brewed by Night Shift, which is the...
Oh, that's what I said.
The task team is working the night shift, I guess you could say, when they're using their night vision goggles. And I'm drinking it because it goes down smooth.
Like this movie.
So my buddy was drinking that.
Oh, shut up for a second. Who's that talking? Next. Great. Now you know. Next up is a man who's joining us. And I don't know which phone he's Zooming us on. Hopefully it's not the shitty phone. Mr. Davey Corsetto, who just got home from going out with some friends who I don't know anything about, but I guess that's okay. That's fine. I'm not upset at all, whatever. Dave, I want to say, what are you drinking? But probably the better question is, what have you been drinking for the last couple hours?
Last couple hours? Let's call it last couple days, my friend.
Oh, boy.
So I'm just drinking regular bourbon right now because it's all I have in the house. So
this guy's I love this class. Sorry, I'm quoting.
I've been literally drinking since 11 o'clock yesterday.
Nice.
Vacation, Dave. Now, for those of you not watching this on YouTube, Last week, Dave joined us from, or last time, Dave joined us from a restaurant. Today, he's lying down, and we'll see if he stays awake. For those of you watching on YouTube, you already have your pants off watching this guy right now. The way he's just lying there, I mean, it is. This is he what is. We brought him in for the hunk factor, and he's showing it right now, lying there in bed.
Okay. Mikey, oh. you brought it tonight with that groovy shirt and that turn back.
What is wrong with the shirt? It's a collared shirt that's like that, you know, that like stuff you could wear to go golfing. It's like a golf shirt. Yeah. Nothing's wrong with it.
Nothing's wrong.
Yeah, fucking 90. It's cool.
What should I wear to work? Like a cool, like cut off, like tank top with my muscles, turn up this a boy's medium like you're wearing?
That's a boy. It's a man's.
A man's medium. A man's petite.
Sorry that my arms can fill it out, Mikey. And goes,
well, right. Okay. They can fill it out. Wonderful. I think I see some track marks. Anyway, Sicario.
Speaking of.
Yeah. So 2015, Sicario. Gentlemen, can you remember when you first saw this movie?
Like a month ago when Chris recommended it to me.
That sounds about right. For me, it was a couple of years ago when Chris recommended it to me. I watched that and then the sequel all around the same time.
I've yet to watch the sequel. I have to watch it.
I don't remember much about it, but I still enjoyed it, I think.
Yeah. The sequel's great also. This first one's better. I was shocked at the Rotten Tomatoes score, which you'll get to, of the sequel. But I don't remember if I heard about it on a podcast much, you know, which is many of the movies I mentioned, but I just first heard about it and saw it, streamed it on something. And I just love Denis' movie, Villeneuve, Prisoners, which Mikey recently saw, Enemy, Dune.
Yeah. Enemy's the one I haven't seen yet. Yep.
But I just love his style.
Arrival. Everything he does is good.
Arrival. Written by Taylor Sheridan, which we've touched on before with Wind River.
Yep, that's the man behind Yellowstone, all kinds of stuff.
I was blown away by the way it's shot, the style, the sound, you know, get into it. But just fantastic story.
That's fantastic story. Fantastic acting.
Fantastic.
Was this one of Blunt's first movies? Or, no, this was not her first. It was probably, a second or third?
Emily Blunt?
Yeah.
Maybe her 30th?
Yeah, I don't think she's unbelievable. That's the
To me, her first one was like The Devil Wears Prada, the first one I remember.
Oh my God, you watched that movie, you fucking weirdo?
Yeah.
Pretty. You fucking
weirdo. Yeah, I did.
Listen, Harry.
Yes.
Anyway, Emily Blunt was fantastic in this movie. Josh Groban, fantastic in this movie.
Josh Groban, he's a wonderful singer. I'm Josh Groban, you asshole.
Stupid
dick. Yes, Josh Brolin. Let me go through the stats real quick before Dave starts naming off other opera singers. 2015, directed by Denis Villeneuve. I think I said that right. Written by Taylor Sheridan, as Chris already said. Starring Emily Blunt, Josh Brolin, Benicio del Toro. Also with Daniel Kaluuya. I think I said that right. John Barenthal and Victor Garba. I put him there, but he was only in it a little bit. A Rotten Tomato score of 92% for the critic, 85% for the audience score, with a Metacritic score of 82 and a cinema score of A-. It's not one of the AFI's top 100 greatest films, but pretty great film on a budget of $30 million, which doesn't seem, it seems like that's a small movie. It only had a box office of $46 million in the U.S. and $38 million internationally. But I think it felt like it was a movie that kind of gained steam on streaming and in home video. Definitely. It was nominated for 3 Academy Awards for...
I'm guessing sound.
I'm sorry, what?
I'm guessing sound. I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely, yes. So it was cinematography, the great Roger Deakins, who's done a ton of stuff. Actually, that lost to The Revenant. Musical score... was this guy named Johan Johansson, rest in peace. He lost to Ennio Marchione for The Hateful Eight. He's also no longer with us. And the best achievement in sound editing, another guy who's no longer with us, who did that, that lost to Mad Max Fury Road.
Oh,
that's a movie we'd do someday.
It sure is. But yeah, the cinematography, the shots in this movie, just unbelievable. Like the night shots and just,
yep.
You just notice how many, and the great overhead shots. There's so many overhead shots of them going into Juarez and the beginning when they're doing the raid, the horrific discovery in Arizona.
Oh my God. Yes. And, a couple movies ago, I harped on British actors who didn't have great American accents. And I thought Emily Blunt and Daniel Kaluuya, because they're both British, they were, you know, you couldn't tell. Like, if you didn't know, they were perfect.
Yeah. Daniel Kaluuya, they're both always great. You know, you think of Emily Blunt and, you know, in Quiet Place or...
Right.
Mary Poppins.
That's right. She was pretty good in Mary Poppins, I'll have to say, yeah.
Mikey saw that, but...
I saw most of it, yeah.
But Daniel Kaluuya is great and everything. And he's, you know, I appreciated him more. When I first saw this, I don't think I knew who he was, or I hadn't seen him, which I've since, you know, he's won multiple Oscars. But he's great in everything. And he's great in his semi-small role. And Josh Groban... Sorry, Brolin. Sorry, the grimace. Just yet another better role, performance and role than Thanos, the grimace. But like you had mentioned last night, you're like, oh, I think he's so great. The more I watched it, the more I'm like, this guy's so slimy.
He's so slimy, but he's so cool doing it.
Yeah, but
I was
just
jealous of that big, thick head of hair.
But why is he slimy?
What are you talking about?
The way he just used Emily Blunt.
Yeah, well, he had to. He needed her.
Well, that's a kind of special slimy guy that has to do that kind of stuff, I guess.
All they're doing. I mean, what do you think the moral of the movie is? It's they have to do shady shit to get who they want. Take down the cartel. They're trying to control, you know, have in charge who they can control, and they do it by, you know, unleashing a hitman who wants his revenge. Speaking of great characters, I mean, obviously
a guy you root for and then hate and then root for and then hate again.
So this is interesting because, like I said, Prisoners, I had mentioned in your podcast, I said it just makes you think, what would you do?
Yep.
I think I said mistakenly said everybody would kidnap somebody, right? I think. But I did mean, I do think every parent would
do whatever they could.
And if this person knows where my child is,
yeah,
they would, you know, try to suppress the matter.
Funny story.
They do that? Okay, what, Dave?
I had a nightmare about 2 years ago that someone kidnapped my son, and I found them in a cave with my grandson Jace. And I was asking this person where my son was, and I ended up asking if he killed him, and he said yes, and he started laughing. And then I asked James to throw me a rock over, and I fucking bashed this guy's skull so violently. And that's where I learned that I would go to the deepest.
That's when we learned that that wasn't a dream, and Dave just confessed.
So when you asked, like, there's a lot of moral dilemma in this movie. You don't know how you would do, I guess, until you're in that moment.
But would you do what he did?
Yeah, I was saying,
no.
You would not, like, what is his name in this? I have it.
Guillermo?
Alejandro Gillick. Alejandro. You wouldn't do what he, like, his family was, you know, he wants his revenge. You can't blame him. You do it.
Yeah.
You would do what most, you know, you're like, I would kill, you know, kill all these guys. But what the end, I don't, you know, like, that's the moral.
No, that's...
Like, these are innocent kids he kills.
Like, up until that moment, you're rooting for him. And then at that moment, you're like, oh, shit.
That's an unbelievable scene, too. Kids last week. I'm sorry?
The movie keeps changing courses. Like, when you first watch the movie, the first scene, you're like, what the fuck am I watching? Like, what is this? And then you're on this mission. Okay, we're going to find the person that did this. And you're like, all right, we're gonna they're searching for this obviously master criminal to bring to justice, and it keeps changing.
You just think it's gonna be like, boom, we're gonna this guy with the corpse, this pure evil, we're gonna take down. I agree, but
that seems almost irrelevant to the movie.
What?
That initial scene.
Yeah, that's just her doing. Oh, yeah. Yeah, right. It just kind of shows.
It really just
her from A to B, kind of.
Right. Yeah. That is Diaz's house, but they have no way of getting him.
Right.
So name. That's how they recruit, you know, Emily Blunt, Kate's character. So, yeah. What I was saying about the wife was, I mean, when he kills the kids and the wife at the end, just the way it's shot, it's unbelievable.
They don't show it, obviously, but.
Probably complicit, you know what I mean? She knows she probably knows her husband has been killed, but innocent kids, you don't. But somehow his character is still so, like, he watches out and cares for Kate's character. He mentions that she reminds him of his daughter. So it's almost like he's like parental, like to her.
Puts a gun to her chin.
But he's somehow still likable. I mean, as you see in the next movie, you're like rooting for him completely. And when that, you know, that turn in the second movie, obviously is that you're rooting for him 100%, which we may do. So I shouldn't.
Here's the thing. His kids were thrown in a vat of acid, were they not?
Yes, his daughter. Yep. Yeah.
Was he there when that happened?
I don't know if that's established.
Was he present when that happened? I don't remember.
It doesn't say that. Probably not. I don't know. They probably would have just killed him. But
the fact is, those kids were basically tortured. Yeah. So how does this guy get to live his life knowing, you know, even if he's going to get killed? I mean, I get it. I'm just taking the devil. I'm being the devil advocate right now, right? I'm being a devil's advocate for Diaz, right? For him. Yeah. He had to watch his own kids get killed first. I know.
Right, still. The order he did. Yeah,
that's fucking brutal.
Then he paused. He waited. He like let him sink in.
Well, you see, wait, how he says, you know, prepare to meet God. But also, you see how damaged he is. Obviously, you see him in the plane when he wakes with like a start, and she's like, "What's going on with this guy?" I love how she keeps looking at him, like, "What's you know, what's up with this guy?" I don't know who he is. They show the
what's
shot
he
of
there
him
for
side of the plane. But so. Kate's character is kind of like it's like the audience's, you know.
Right, like I'm watching going, wait, what the hell is going on? Oh, wait, she doesn't even know what's going on, so.
And you know what? Let's go through I'll go through the plot real,
sure.
real quick. We'll bang it out, and then we'll talk about the scenes and three things make this so fantastic. So, all right, Chandler, Arizona, FBI agents Kate Macer and Reggie Wayne. I didn't know that was his name. Reggie Wayne, not the one who actually doesn't mind working hard. They raid a cartel house and they discover dozens of, I love how they do it too, decaying corpses behind the walls. Outside of booby trap kills two officers. After the raid, Kate is recommended for and joins a task force led by CIA officer Matt Graver. I'm sorry, he's with the DOD, that's what he says, right? And Alejandro Gillick. Mexican ex-prosecutor turned CIA trained assassin. Mission is to flush out a Sonoma leader, Manuel Diaz, who is hiding in the U.S. So they're going to get his brother in. She doesn't know this. She thinks they're going to El Paso. So the team includes Delta Force Rangers, CIA, and they travel to Juarez to extradite Diaz's brother, Guillermo. So team gets ambushed, as Dave mentioned. Scene was pretty intense by the cartel hitmen on the way back, and they kill them all. Kate's forced to kill Federale. So when they get back, Alejandro torches the brother. Does he rape him? I've looked online. I don't know if he waterboards him.
Well, I thought the jug was to waterboard him, yeah.
What do you keep looking at me for? No armless in glass, remember?
No.
Well, that's what they make you think. I don't know. He's doing some weird things, and
he's intimidating him quite well. Because when he walked in the door, the look on that guy's face changed. He looked over at Brolin like, what? Yeah.
He's and Brolin's a sicko, right? He's like, I'm going to stay here. But the other guy's like, I'm out of here. So,
he looks like he's putting his dick in his face, too.
Yeah. Right. Does. So they learn.
Sure does.
Drugs. Kate confronts Matt, says, what's going on? The real mission is to be led to drug lord Fausto Alacon. Task Force raids a bank used to launder Diaz's money. Kate and Reggie want to start a legal case, but they're ordered to stand down. So at a bar, Reggie introduces Kate to Ted, the great John Bernthal, as you mentioned. They hook up, and he ends up trying to strangle her when she figures he's in on the take. So Alejandro comes in and saves her. He ends up beating Ted to get information, finds out who else is working with the cartel.
You don't want me to talk to you and you keep fucking hitting me. How many other corrupt motherfuckers are you working with on this side of the border? Look, it's exactly what I told you, all right? They came to me and they wanted details about our case. And yes, I did it. I gave it to them, but I never wanted anybody to get hurt. And I would have never gotten involved in pieces of shit if I thought that there was fuck! Okay! Okay, it's not what we're looking for, Ted. You know what the beauty is of you being so beat to a pulp? Because no one's gonna notice a few more scratches. This is a new deal, Ted. I'm the one who decides whether your daughter get federal protection or whether we post your ex-wife's address on the internet. I decide whether you go to prison in a work camp in Missouri or a kill house like Corcoran. This is where you negotiate how to survive, my friend.
Okay. Look. I feel like this whole thing's just gotten away from me. I fucked up. Okay, I fucked up, but I'm in over my fucking head right now. I'm sorry if I... Fuck, get it out! Get it the fuck out! Fuck, get it the fuck out, all right? Get it out! Motherfucker! Fuck you! Fuck!
How many officers do they have working on the force?
I'll tell you, if you think you want to know, you just gotta promise me that my daughters, that they're gonna be safe, okay? You make me that promise.
You want the truth?
Please.
Give me all the names of all the motherfuckers they got working on the force.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
So which phone do we start with?
It's that one. It's the shitty one.
That's the shitty one?
Yes, sir.
So they find out Diaz has been recalled, which is they were waiting for, and they prepare to raid the tunnel. Matt reveals they are using Kate because the CIA can't operate independently in the U.S.
Only reason she's there. Yep.
Used the whole time. Reggie wants to leave, but Kate wants to find out the true mission. During the gunfight, Kate follows Alejandro into Mexico, sees him abduct a corrupt police officer, and goes to arrest him.
Freeze! Step away from him.
Put that down.
I mean it. Move away from him right now.
Don't ever point a weapon at me again. Catch your breath. Get back up there.
Shoots her in her vest and just to subdue her and drives away with Silvio, the cop, at gunpoint. So Kate confronts Matt again, who admits mission is to consolidate cartel into one entity they can better control. So Alejandro was hired to assassinate Alacon, the man responsible for ordering the murder of his wife and daughter. So Alejandro kills Silvio after having him stop Diaz. Then he has Diaz drive him to the estate. Kills Diaz and the guards. It's a great scene.
I thought it was like by accident. Like he was just caught. He just shot through him basically to take the other guy out. But I guess
No, I think he cuts his throat.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm thinking of the police officer.
Yeah, police officer. No, I think he's like this corrupt cop. This guy's corrupt.
But you kind of felt bad for him a little.
He shoots him in the head, and he shoots.
It shows a cop with his son multiple times with the movie. Yeah. That's a little bad.
Yeah, exactly. That's a little side story. So finally, he kills. Like I said, he kills all the guards and finds his family, and then he, you know, kills the family, and then Alar Khan, as we discussed. So next day, Alejandro forces Kate to sign a statement attesting
that everything I did was fine. Please.
Yeah. She points a pistol at him after he leaves, and as he's leaving, but she can't pull the trigger. So, end movie. So,
well, then we see one last scene of that police officer's son.
Yep.
We see violence, and it's just violence every other day for them.
Exactly. So,
God. So, I have one question.
Yep.
How do you get your parents to stop making love in front of you?
No, why would I ask that? That's silly. Anyway, what a preposterous thing. God, talk about ruining a good thing. Now, listen, what about... So she sees the bracelet that John Barenthal brings in. Oh. I know we see the bracelet on the guy had it at his house in his hand.
Yep.
But I missed, like, what is that bracelet?
Well,
like, is it just a bracelet to show that they're part of the, like, how did she know about that bracelet?
Those were just the rubber bands on the cash.
Oh, okay.
So he was depositing that money, or having someone deposit that, even to the loan that they, you know, wasn't even, they explained that the IRS couldn't touch them, whatever. But those elastics,
okay, that's what that's from. Okay, I missed that. I thought it was one of those like bracelets. Okay.
Nope. So I love how they show that scene. Bernthal's always great. He's gun bag, but they show him take his stuff out of his pocket when they're hooking up, puts it on the table. You don't see what it is.
And it's blurry. Yep.
Such a so well done.
And Brolin said, don't go in the bank. Oh, Kate, don't go in the bank because you're going to get your face on camera.
Right. He was right.
But see, even the banker was like looking like, what are you making me do?
And they're like, oh, we're going to get a case on them. They're like, really? This is, you know.
Well, she thought they were legitimately going after them to build a case to take them out. She had no idea.
Like, she wants to do good in this whole thing. Her character makes no difference. She's a sucker, right?
Really? Yeah. She's just there.
Literally made no difference in the movie.
Well, that's why they didn't want her partner, because they're like, listen, she'll be the easier one to take.
He's a lawyer. I love that. I love how they were talking about it, you know. So, but yeah,
says that, but Del Toro is a lawyer too. He's a prosecutor.
Yeah.
/ hitman.
Yeah. A little different because, I think he put that, all he's doing is one thing now, and he's,
And there was one line that I took note of where, I don't know if, I think it was Del Toro that said it. He said,
you're asking me how a watch works. For now, let's just keep an eye on the time.
It's great.
It was like,
it's great lines.
That seemed like I was trying to understand, like, you're looking too much at the details instead of the big picture, or, you know, what you're here for. I don't know. It's such a great line, though.
It really was. There was some great, there's some great dialogue in this. Right, and who's the actor? He's been in a few other things. Who plays one of the guys on their team when they go into? He's talking the whole time.
You know, is that the guy who says excuses himself? I think it's Jeffrey Donovan, or he's like in Burn Notice. He was in other things, but that was the show he was on for years.
He was great. What's it called? Wrath of Man.
Oh, that's right. He was in that too. Yeah.
He was great. He was great. His little role, he was obnoxious, just, you know, nonstop talking at the driving up, like the tent scene. So,
and I like the scene with
go for that one night stand until she realized that guy was up to no good. I gave her props for that.
That she was gonna go for it. Is that what you're saying? Give her props for her horniness.
Right.
Bravo. You're such a gentleman.
She.
But what a scene that was, though. What a fucking scene that was.
That was great.
The Bernthal's wasn't going to kill her until he looked like he was had to.
He was like apologizing, and then you see the blurry, unfocused, like shot of Del Toro walking in, just nonchalant.
So great, yeah. And then
the fucking massive ass beating in the car.
He's giving him a willy. He's
great.
Eyebrow.
Roland's laughing, just like ha ha, good times.
Brolin's seen a lot of shit, you could tell, right? It's a sicko.
He's one of those guys that's been in the trenches for so long. He's like, just don't give it. Let's just get this fucking done.
Wearing his flip flops.
I don't mind him. I don't mind him at all in this movie. The guy's got a job, and that's what his job is.
He's a scumbag.
What makes him a scumbag?
He completely used her. So
yeah, but that's what they made him do.
No, they didn't make him do it.
What do you mean? Yeah. Obviously, everyone's got a higher power.
Yeah, I mean,
I guess he couldn't have kept, he didn't have to keep her in the dark. Maybe.
I don't know. Yeah,
your parents keep you in the dark all the time. What's the difference? They put you in the closet every time.
I know it's coming. She didn't know.
Is that before they sing? Yeah. Him? They play the music.
They sing Josh Groban music.
They sing the theme to Polar Express to me.
Josh Groban and Roy Schneider. No, and who else did he? Rob Schneider. So, this is the three things I think that make this movie great. Reasons I love it. So, one is I mentioned this. That's the score, the sound, right? Intense drums, just upping the tension, right out of the gates, right, and just whenever they're going on a mission. So, and then the plot number two, plot misdirect, which we just mentioned, we thought it was one thing, very unpredictable. She's just used the whole time. Makes no difference whether it didn't matter one bit who they took in that role, right? Mm-hmm. So. The third reason, great cast that we mentioned. Del Toro's unbelievable. Josh.
Del Toro.
Brolin. Kaluuya. Bernthal. Blunt is ridiculous. She could have been nominated.
Did Benicio Del Toro does like some of the craziest stuff in this movie. Does he raise his voice ever? Like he just cool, calm, relaxed the entire time.
He really is. His character.
When you've gone through what he's gone through, I mean, what the hell the other guy rise out of anymore and just fucking do your job, right?
I thought
I'd be anyone, I'd be him in this movie. I think I'd be him.
No, I think I so like too. Him.
Yeah.
He's about right.
Fuck that.
Kill children. Okay.
Yeah. I'd be Victor Garbo, just stay home.
What's that?
I'd be Victor Garbo, just stay back and you know, stay in the office.
What was the show he was on?
He was on Alias. That was his big one. Dave and I watched him on a show called Eli Stone.
With Jennifer Garner?
Yeah, with Jennifer Garner, yep.
What's that show?
Alias.
Oh, Alias.
Yeah, Alias, yep.
Alias. I thought you said some A-list.
A-list. Oh, he's an A-lister right now.
He is an A-lister. So, overall, very entertaining movie. Just very unique. Well shot. Unbelievably acted.
Just all around.
Was the highway scene, which was so fucking intense.
Don't move! Cumberton!
No! Compas. Suelta la pistola. Tírela.
Huh?
Pregunta, paisanos. ¿Quieren morir?
What the fuck are we doing?
Thank you.
Which Emily Blunt had no idea what the fuck was going on.
And it was so nonchalant the way they just went in, took them out, and just kind of went on.
They're like, don't do it. Like, everyone had their fucking guns going. They're all in the fucking public.
Yeah. And they're like, this isn't even going to make the news.
And they're like, don't get out of the car unless they got out of the car. And then the guy gets up, and then what's his name? Gets out of the car, and then boom, boom, boom. They showed the other car is staring at like Federale's body. Now, I don't know. He must have been a corrupt. He was going to shoot, or he tried to shoot Kate.
Yeah.
Didn't really make much sense. If he did shoot her, what would have happened? They would have just shot him.
Yep. But they just don't.
Great scene. The obviously the last scene was fucking fantastic.
It was.
And did bloody and kids died, but oh well.
No, the scene, it was ridiculous how he took Sylvia.
The dialogue between the two of them in front of the family was so fucking tense.
Every night you have families killed, and yet here you dine. Tonight should be no different.
Come on. Come on. Do you think the people that sent you here are any different? Who do you think we learned it from? The grieving lawyer. Your wife. You think she'd be proud of what you've become?
Don't forget about my daughter.
Ah, sí. Tu hijita. No fue personal.
Para mí sí.
In front of my boys.
Ahora vas a conocer a Dios. Finish your meal.
And the guy mentioned,
it's like, do you speak English? Do they speak English? No, then we'll speak English.
And then he says, right, he says, and your little girl, he's like, well, nothing was personal. You know what I mean?
Ooh. Yeah. Well, I mean, the guy that was in charge of the cartel was like, listen, we're above this shit. Like, they're eating their fine dinner.
Beautiful house.
In their rooftop friggin' house, beautiful home, while the entire city's blowing up.
Right.
I mean, they're showing them driving the streets with people hanging from bridges.
Oh, yeah, they showed people. We forgot to even mention that. That was ridiculous.
So the amount of just complete debauchery going on in that fucking country while he's sitting and eating at the lap of luxury. It's like, fuck you.
Yep.
That's why I love that scene. It was so great.
Yep. I do appreciate he didn't kill the cook or the maid or whatever the
I do love how the look on his face too, just of anguish, the scumbag.
Oh, after, yes.
Like, you know, after he killed his family, like, blah, 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 and he just, I mean, he knew. So.
I mean, I think you have to, I mean, to get results, I guess you have to sink to the level of the people you're dealing with.
And he is that level, right? He's part of the other cartel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or he's them too, right. Which is in accord with the CIA to get who they wanted to, you know, in there to control. Was, right. They're like, oh, there's too much uncertainty, too much, what's the word I'm looking for? Imbalance.
Yes. Unstableness, yeah. Whatever the word is.
Stableness. That's what I was thinking.
Unstabilization.
It's like when they're doing, like, when they do their thing with you, don't they teach you, like, the English literature?
Guys, I got to tell you, nobody's into me making love to my parents more than David. I mean, that is his kink.
I mean, you know.
Everyone has one.
We're all into something, but yeah.
He's into his fourth grade teacher and his oldest friend. Yeah. Nobody cool.
Normal.
Totally cool.
Under boobs.
So,
great movie.
Great movie indeed. And we did decide what we're doing next, right?
Yeah.
Davey, what are we doing next? You like apples?
I'll fake it through the day with some help from Johnny Walker Red. Send the poison rain down the drain to put bad thoughts in my head.
How do you like those apples, Mikey? Apples that are on your chest.
Apples on my chest. God.
You have man titties, don't you?
Now is Matt Damien in this next movie?
Yes, he is.
Yeah. I'm just gonna stare at you.
Look at your stupid face.
I'm just gonna stare at you. I'm stupid face. Let's put a poll out there. If you're seeing this on YouTube, just the face alone. Who has a cuter face? It's me.
No, it's not you.
So yes, next time, ladies and gentlemen, we're gonna be doing a Good Will Hunting, which I haven't seen in many, many years. I'm gonna say a few things before Dave starts talking about my family loving again. You can find us on Twitter at @fine_movies. You can find us on Instagram and Threads at @finemovies, Fine Spirits. You can find Dave at any bar, any time of day. It doesn't matter. Or calling me any time of day, all day.
Or if they have oysters.
All right, we're done. We're out of here. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Thank you for all for subscribing. Chris, any final words?
I already miss Martha's Vineyard. I already miss last
week. You see any sharks, Chris?
What's that?
You see any sharks?
I did not see any sharks.
Shark sightings at all?
No, it's the best. The kids love where we go in right in front of our inn. There's like a sandbar. We go in.
Do you go every year the same place?
Yes.
Yeah, all right,
that's great. Great vacation talk. Dave, any parting words?
Oh, this is pod still going on?
We talk about great movies while drinking. We talk about great movies while drinking. Yeah, we talk about great movies while drinking.
Subscribe.
We feel fine.
I met one of your fans yesterday, Mikey.
Oh, well, cool. This is just like a phone call. One of the 75 you've made to me this week.
First of all, you answered me twice today, you fucker.
Because I work, dickface. You're on vacation. I'm not on vacation.
You can pick up the phone.
This is when I'll pick up the phone. Hey, I watched another episode of Arrested Development. It was very funny. Thank you, David. Thank you. Can I go now? Every day, Christopher. If I showed you my phone.
I fret with friends, but I text.
Exactly. I can text. I can answer you 10 minutes later on a text if I have the time. I look at my phone and it's like Sideshow Bob when he goes, ugh. I'm like, you know, whatever. So this is
looks so stupid on you.
This is my shirt. I wore this for work. I don't know. It's a shirt.
It looks dumb as hell.
It's a collared shirt.
Fans, not experts.